This is Thursday, January 7, 2016. We are in Natick, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's continuing Veterans Oral History Project. My name is Maureen Sullivan. Our cameraman is Dan McDermott of Natick Pegasus. We are privileged to have with us today David Gallo. Welcome, David.
Nice to be here.
May I ask when you were born?
December 3rd, 1961.
And where were you born?
Wilmington, Massachusetts.
And what town do you currently live in?
Natick, Massachusetts.
Your marital status?
I'm married.
Do you have children?
I have two children, a son and a daughter.
Grandchildren?
No grandchildren.
So before the interview, you mentioned that you spent most of your childhood in Linfield. Tell us about your childhood.
It was a great small town to grow up in. I grew up in a fairly big family, six kids, there were six of us, and just playing baseball and soccer and going to school and things like that.
And what did your parents do for a living?
My father was an engineer working for Avco, and they were a defense contractor working in the missile industry. And my mother was a homemaker.
And your father served?
World War II in the Navy.
Any stories about him?
You know, he never really, it wasn't until I decided to join the service that he really ever talked about the Navy. He was at the very tail end of World War II, and the one story he always told me was, he was coming back from leave one day, and he was late, and he actually had to jump from the dock onto the ship, and that was the only real story I ever heard of his, and I think that was the last time he was ever late for anything.
Oh, good for your father. So you went to Linfield High School?
That's correct.
And what year did you graduate?
1979.
And what, did you go to college?
Yeah, I went to Salem State College and studied accounting.
When did you enter the military?
1984.
So that was right after college.
Yeah, I was, I wasn't one of the younger guys going in. I was enlisted. I went in as enlisted, even though I finished college, just because I was just kind of see what it was like and see how much I enjoyed it.
And what branch did you choose?
It was the Army.
And get a little bit more about going into the Army in the early 1980s. It was kind of Cold War-ish.
Yeah, it was a different time. It was just starting to get to the point where it was a little bit more popular to go in the military. You talk to the older folks who had been through the late 70s, and it was, you'd hide the fact that you were in the military, and you wouldn't be that proud of it, and you wouldn't be wearing your uniform when you didn't have to. And by the time I got in, it was different. It was, you'd drive by in your Jeeps and they'd be out cheering for you. And so it was definitely the Cold War, and that's what they were drilling into our heads. You know, the war that we're gonna fight is tanks in Germany, and be ready for that. And we spent all those years doing reforger exercises in Germany, and you just say, well, this could be the battlefield. You're looking around, and it was different.
Well, let's get you out of Germany for the moment and get you back into basic training. Yeah. So you're in the Army now, and where would you send for basic?
Fort McClellan, Alabama.
Was this the first time you were out of the state?
Yeah, first time I ever flew on a plane. First time obviously Maine and New Hampshire and stuff for vacations, but it was the first time I ever traveled, first time I ever traveled by myself.
And the first time you were in Alabama.
Yeah, that's true too.
Tell us what basic was like.
Oh, it was, I talk to people about it now. It was a lot of fun, but it wasn't fun to go through. It wasn't fun when I was there. You get these great friends and everything, but you're just being yelled at all the time, and you're tired all the time, and you're cold all the time. Even Alabama in the winter, it's cold, and you're outside all day long, and you're tired, and all you want to do is sleep, and all you want to do is go inside and be warm, and you don't really get that chance.
And this was the first time also you met people from other parts of the country.
That's correct.
What was that like?
It was very eye-opening, but I loved it. I ate it up. I, you know, my the my battle buddy was from Illinois. I met, you know, folks from New York City, from Wisconsin, from a lot of folks from down south, and it was great.
Okay. You have a background in accounting.
Yes.
What did the Army do with you?
Well, I got to choose. I guess I scored fairly good on the ASVAB, and I got to choose. And I won. I wanted to go into military police because I was thinking about law enforcement, even with an accounting degree. FBI loves accounting degrees, and I was thinking about law enforcement. But I did not want to do finance in the Army. That just sounded so boring to me. And I thought military police sounded exciting. I didn't really know what they do. I didn't know what the Army MPs did. You know, I just thought, oh, it'd be cool to be a cop. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
wasn't really what I did.
You found out soon enough.
Yeah.
After basic, what happened next?
Originally, it was stationed at Fort McClellan. Mm-hmm. So I got to stay there. But I was able to do a short enlistment because MPs were able to do a short enlistment, and then the rest of your 8-year enlistment was in the National Guard. So shortly after there, and a short time in Grafenwöhr, Germany, I was in the National Guard stationed here at the 972nd Military Police Company in West Newton.
All right, so let's get you into Germany. Yeah. And how long were you stationed in Germany?
6 months.
Only 6 months?
Yes.
And you mentioned, well, what part of Germany was that again?
Grafenwöhr.
Grafenwöhr. And I'm assuming this is West Germany, right?
That's West Germany.
Thank you.
Correct.
Got to remember, they didn't unify for
a couple
of years yet.
That's right.
And what was your experiences in Germany like?
It was neat. Well, a lot of what we did was what they call route reconnaissance, and you'd basically be driving around the countryside, the Bavarian countryside, marking up maps. And making sure that if tanks had to roll through this town, would they be able to make it between these two buildings? Are the roads too sharply turned? Can you get this type of unit through this type of thing? What would slow them down? Bridges. Would the equipment be able to go over the bridges in those towns? So you did map overlays and sent them up to headquarters, and they'd be able to put together a grander scheme.
Seems kind of strange, because actually driving around the countryside when nowadays all they have to do is press a couple of buttons
That's
on the
true.
Computer.
Yep.
You did a lot of the dirty work for
That's
that.
That's right. That's right.
Okay, so now your 6 months in Germany is over. You're mm-hmm. back in the States.
Yep.
What year is this now?
1986.
And what rank are you at?
At that point, I had already become a sergeant.
Okay. Where are we stationed now?
At the 972nd Military Police Company in West Newton.
With the National Guard?
That's right.
Okay. A little bit closer to home.
Yeah, that's right.
And what were your duties with the 972nd?
I was in a military police platoon. Mm-hmm. So basically, it's just training. There are some real-world missions, such as every year as the marathon goes through here, where you know we'd be out doing crowd control for the marathon, or if there was an air show at Hanscom Air Force Base, we'd do that. But most of what we did was prepare in our battlefield missions, which is, like I said, route reconnaissance or battlefield circulation control, a little bit of enemy prisoner of war containment, but that's not really our focus. But It was those type of jobs.
Let's go a little bit more into detail about, say, what your uniform was like back in the 1980s. Yeah. I mean, these days you're talking about soldiers who are wearing full body armor.
That's right. Yeah, yeah. I never put on body armor until I was mm-hmm. I was activated for a combat mission, and it was not very good body armor. But you know, we had, you know, just our battle dress uniforms, it was a big deal when we finally got Kevlar helmets, because the active duty had just gotten them and had gotten them, and we were still wearing the steel pots they had worn in all through Vietnam and the Korean War and actually World War II. Yeah, so it was very different. And we in the National Guard we were still carrying the old 45s. where the Army had just gone to the Beretta 9mm. And to be honest with you, everyone was jealous of us getting to still carry the 45s because the 9mm would jam and it's big in your hand and it's, yeah, you get to carry 15 rounds, but they were 15 9mm rounds, which are not nearly as effective as the 45s. So we were envied by the active duty in that case, but we were driving old, crummy Jeeps, and they would break down because the rust in the gas tanks would get into the fuel filter, and we'd be stopping every few minutes to clean out the fuel filter, and they were driving new Humvees. We hadn't gotten the Humvees yet, so yeah, it was a lot of old equipment.
Welcome to the last days of the Cold War.
That's right. That's right.
Now, you're in the National Guard. Are you full-time, part-time?
Part-time.
Part-time. Yep. So, what are you doing for full-time?
At the time, I was working at the State House. I was an aide to a state representative for a couple of years, and then I worked on his campaign. And then, just before 1990, when I was the operations director for Bill Weld, who was running for governor at the time. And I actually worked in his administration for a couple of years, but that was after I got back from Desert Storm. His campaign for governor was in 1990. The election was in November. 2 weeks later, my unit got mobilized for Desert Storm.
Wow.
Yeah.
So tell us a little more about Desert Storm.
Okay, so it was November of 1990, my unit gets called up, and we spent November, December, and the first half of January at Fort Devens, Massachusetts, which is great, and it's a shame that base is closed down because what was great about that is the units get mobilized and they're there, you get time off on the weekends, your family can come up. If you're at Fort Drum or Fort Dix, that's a big difference. You're not going to be able to see your family. So we were very, very lucky that Fort Devens was still there at the time. So we prepared, and basically National Guard reserve units have to get checked off by the active duty to make sure that they're proficient in the missions that they're going to be performing, because active duty components go through this all the time. The reserve component, you know, we train as best we can, but we only have, you know, maybe 39, 40 training days in a year. So we have to get checked out. We got checked out, and we got attached to the, we started finding out what our mission was going to be, and we got, we found out who our units are, you know, who we're going to be attached to, our higher headquarters were going to be, and so the 118th MP Battalion out of Rhode Island was going to be our battalion headquarters, and we were going to be attached to the 14th Military Police Brigade, which is part of the 7th Corps. We were very lucky that our company was pulled out and we were cut under the operation control of the 1st Infantry Division. They're known as the Big Red One, and it's a great historical, division, and we got to work very closely with their headquarters. I tell you, I was intense with their commanding generals and their commanding general or their assistant commanding generals a number of times, getting briefed on the enemy, getting briefed on the mission, and briefing them on things that we were doing for them. So it was a really neat group to be a part of.
So at the time your unit was called up, what was your rank?
I was a staff sergeant.
All righty. And assuming that your unit was prepped and ready to go, when did you go?
January 15th, I think it was. It was very late at night that we finally found out that we were going, maybe it was probably the 14th, and it took us, and we ended up landing on the 15th in Saudi Arabia. So
this is getting close to the 25th anniversary now.
That's right.
Isn't it?
That's right. That's right.
You're now in Saudi Arabia.
Yes.
What part of Saudi?
We flew into, I think it was Riyadh, and we were only there for a short, very short period of time. We had to go to the port. That's where our trucks came, our Jeeps, our Humvees came in. And then we drove up to an area just north of the city of Hafer al-Batin.
Were you part of the first units?
Well, the first units got over there in November.
Okay.
We couldn't go until the 1st Infantry Division got there, and that they got there on I think the 7th of January, and we got there just shortly after that.
Your first visit to Saudi Arabia.
No,
what was that like?
It's funny because we landed and it was raining, and I think that was the last time we saw rain for months. And it was warm. It was like it was middle of January. It was like 80 degrees and raining, and the Arabian Desert is hot in the summer, but it's fairly miserably cold in the winter. You know, in the mornings anyway. And I said, "Oh, I can deal with this." And no, the next morning we get up at 4:15, and where are my gloves? Where's my hat? Where's my winter jacket, and we froze. So it wasn't anything like I thought, anything like what we were expecting when we landed. But you know, shortly after, that's we found out what it was really going to be like.
And what were going to be your duties?
We were, again, with the 1st Infantry Division. They were going to be, I don't know if folks remember, they called it the Hail Mary, where the initial emphasis, the initial attack was by the Marines straight into Kuwait, and that wasn't the all-out attack. What really was going to happen is we wanted to draw their attention there. We had moved far to the west, and were coming up around, go through Iraq into just to the west of Kuwait, and we were waiting for them to when they saw the Marines coming, they left fast. So our job was to make sure that the 1st Infantry Division, which is an armored infantry division, and the 1st UK, which is an armored division, a tank division, basically. The first UK is a British unit. We were to make sure that their lines of tanks could get from the back to the front fast. And you don't want your tank commander and your armored personnel carriers having to worry about land navigation, or you know, where are we going? We had Humvees with a sign that says "Follow Me," and they took off and those tanks going 50 miles an hour, as fast as they could from the back to the front, and that's how you surprise them. And that's we moved so fast that we had to slow down because we couldn't keep the fuel coming up to the tanks. We moved so fast, and it was great. I was in Iraq before the ground war started. It was kind of cool, kind of fun, interesting, and we were the front line for a very short period of time. As soon as they got past us, they kept going. Another unit took them from there, and you know, we were pretty, you know, within 18 hours of ground war started, we were far in the back. So our mission was passage of lines, a battlefield circulation control, moving units from the back to the front.
And you're no longer dealing with old weapons and old jeeps or anything. No.
We got some of the first. We got GPS before people got GPS. All the other units were, you know, we got the GPS because we were navigation. We were basically navigation for them, and it was great. We had no idea what it was. We still couldn't believe how it worked. You know, the satellites are telling us where to go. Now it's. Every kid knows how to do it, but back then it was kind of neat. Yeah, it was funny because when you get hooked up with the unit like the 1st Infantry Division, the spigot gets turned on. You get equipment, you get men, you get whatever you need. You get good food, you know, everything. And it was kind of neat to be in that because being in the National Guard for at that point had been, you know, 4 years. You didn't get anything.
Did you have a chance to, you mentioned you're basically very quickly back of the line.
That's right.
Did you have a chance to interact with any of the natives?
Not in Iraq.
Not in Iraq.
Because we were south of any city in Iraq. Mm-hmm. But we did in Saudi Arabia. We could go into, you know, we'd go through the city and you'd see some folks. And in Kuwait, we got to, for the 1 or 2 days off that we had in Kuwait, we go into Kuwait City, and this was after the ground war had ended. And we could go in the city. There was no power. I mean, it had been bombed out pretty bad at that point. But it was kind of neat to be in a city at that point. So,
how did the native population treat you guys?
You know, the Saudis were funny. they were friendly to us, but you didn't feel like it was a real friendly. And you know, you just say, oh, if you had the advantage, if you didn't think that, you know, if you thought you could get away with it, I don't know what you'd do to us. But you know, there were talks of snipers and stuff. I didn't see any of that. But you know, they were nice. You'd go into their shops and you could buy candy or soda and stuff like that. And I didn't feel like it was a trusting relationship. So, but they were nice to us. They smiled and they didn't throw things at us. So,
well, that's good. How about the Kuwaits?
Kuwaits were great. Mm-hmm. You know, they had been through a very, very difficult time. You know, just horrible atrocities are committed against them. They were pretty glad we were there. You know, that we were liberating soldiers to them, and it was, you know, the way they had been treated by the Iraqis was not good. You know, and, you know, many of the civilians had been killed. You know, just mm-hmm. executed if they thought there was a threat of anything. And the women were not treated well either, in many ways, much worse. And we had two Kuwaiti interpreters with us. They were actually Kuwaiti citizens that were in college in the United States at the time of the attack. So they, you know, they put them in uniforms and gave them to us so we could interact. And it was neat because they were with us when we go into the city, so they could, you know, kind of tell us what was going on. Their English was excellent. They were, you know, college students in the United States, and it was, you know, you'd have to hold them back sometimes when dealing with prisoners and stuff, because they were not happy, obviously.
The interpreters or the prisoners?
The interpreters. The interpreters. They know what these prisoners, they know what the Iraqi soldiers had done, you know. Uh-huh. And
alrighty. And how long were you in Kuwait?
Kuwait for maybe 2 or 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. And this was after the ground war was over, but we were still in control of it, of prisoners. And part of our job was to oversee a prison camp there, and mm-hmm. and we gave aid and food to the prisoners. Many of them were, you know, many of them had spoke English. The officers had lived in the United States at some point, and you know, they were nice to us too, because we were giving them food. You know, we were treating them better than their headquarters had treated them. So, and we were taking care of their injuries and things like that. So,
during the time you were stationed out there, first, did you see or hear anything like, hey, we're going to invade Iraq?
Well, we had him. Oh, you mean, right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, you know what? We did get enough of the news that we were told what the mission was. And it didn't really seem to us like that was going to happen, that once it was over, the mission was accomplished. We didn't feel it was going to be, you know, we worried about it because, mm-hmm. you know, nothing worse than finishing a successful military campaign and having to do some more of it. And but I, looking back, I barely remember talk of it, but I do remember some talk of it.
Mm-hmm. Is there any other experiences of Desert Storm that you like to relate?
Yeah, you know. It was interesting to work with the prisoners. You know, that was one of the things that I really recall. And you know, they had been, you know, it was a good month and a half that they were getting bombed every day, and they were hurt and they were scared. And they always talked about is that, you know, watch the minefields behind where they were, because they were basically put up front and mined behind, so they couldn't go back. And maybe that was true, maybe that wasn't, but they were not treated well by their higher headquarters. I can't even imagine a soldier being treated like that by their higher headquarters. And they were very grateful to us, and it was interesting. I just remember one thing our commander said to us the night before the ground war started, and he just took us aside. He goes, you know, you do what you have to do to protect yourself, you do what you have to do to, you know, complete your mission. But the minute you see those guys surrender, remember they're soldiers just like you were, and you treat them with respect. And that was something that I remember today.
Indeed. Tell us a little more background on the ground war.
Mm. Yeah, it was, so our mission, I just remember the first thing, we did almost a full-scale exercise or practice. And it's funny, because that's in the military, they always teach you, you practice your mission before you do the mission. So we went out into the desert of Saudi Arabia, and we set up the same lanes, you know, 30 kilometers long, and we had our guys meet up with a tank unit, not the full unit, maybe two tanks from a tank company, and we let them go, and we set it up just like it was going to be at the border. And so the ground war, that was our preparation for the ground war. And one of the neat things about the ground war was it was set up as the same way you would set up going over a stream or a river or something like that. It was called passage of lines, and it was the same operation for passing through an obstacle, because you had the berm, and there was a berm about 25 feet high that the Iraqis had put at the border, and we just blew through that. And then there was a minefield. They said, don't think of it any differently than if you were trying to get across a bridge on a river. And that's what it was like. And that was kind of a neat way to look at it.
We're now in, say, spring of 91?
Yeah.
Ground war is pretty much over with?
Yep.
What happened next?
Boredom.
Boredom!
We sat around here. And it's starting to get hot, too. You know, it's, say, the beginning of April, because beginning of April, you wake up in the morning and it's already 103 degrees. And you know it's going to get a lot hotter as the day goes by. And sandstorms, where you can't open your mouth without getting a mouthful of sand. Oh, and there's nothing to do. There's so many folks over there, you're just waiting for your turn to go home. So you clean your equipment. You get your trucks and your big equipment on the ships, and that's the last you see of that. And then you just hang it. We'd moved back at that point. We had gone to a few different places through Kuwait, and then back into Iraq. And now we're back in Saudi Arabia. We're at a place called King Khalid Military City, which is like a military academy and a post for the army of Saudi Arabia. We set up there, but it was nice because, you know, they had showers there, which we hadn't had, and they had bathrooms there, which we hadn't had, and they had shops, stores, and restaurants, not real restaurants, but like a chicken stand or something like that, so you could buy food and stuff like that. So, and you had access to the PX, and you had access to the phones, which was nice. So we just sat there for a couple weeks waiting for our turn to get on the plane and come home.
And I guess you did.
We did, finally.
Where did you fly back to?
We flew back to, it was Westover Air Force Base in Western Massachusetts.
Were you received well?
Oh, gosh, yeah. The ceremony, the arrival was great because your family was there, and first time you'd seen him in a long time, and so it was great. The great thing about the families is, you know, my wife barely knew anybody else in the unit before. They all became friends, and they're still friends. They're incredibly close friends today. Sunday we're going to a brunch, you know, with those folks, and so your families were there, and they were different. You know, they had changed too. So the welcome back was great. Then we spent, you spent two days on active duty out processing at Fort Devens. But you could come home at night. They had barracks for you, but you could have your car there, which was nice. And then the town of Natick was great to us. You know, it was the 4th of July parade. That was about a month and a half after that. And, you know, that was just terrific. And we got, members of the unit got invited to New York City for the ticker tape parade, which is great. I was starting a new job the longest time I had ever been out of work was May 5th through June 5th is that month before I started my job for the Weld Administration. So.
And of course, that seems to be so different from a few years before, especially post-Vietnam.
Oh, yeah. I had neighbors who were Vietnam veterans, and they're like, they welcomed you home, and they were glad you were home and stuff. They're like, we never got anything like this. Mm-hmm. We never got anything like this. It was clearly a different type of war. There was no draft. The people with the Vietnam War, people came home by themselves. They didn't come home as units. Your unit comes home. The families in the unit know each other. You know, you could be when in Vietnam, these guys were 18-year-old kids. They come home. They get transportation home, and they're not coming home with a group. There's no way you can put a celebration together for one guy, other than maybe their family, and the neighborhood. But it couldn't have been organized any bigger than that. So it was very different.
So you have a new job with the Weld Administration, and you're back with the Guard.
That's right. And it was one of those things where I probably would have left after my initial 8 years, which would have been in 92, if it wasn't for Desert Storm. And after that, I said, you know what, I can. Weekend a month, 2 weeks in the summer, I can do this, And it was right after that I decided to become to go to officer candidate school and become a commissioned officer.
So where did you go?
It was at the Mass Military Academy at Camp Edwards, Massachusetts. And that was 17 months of weekends and two-week duties. It's based on the Fort Benning Officer Candidate School program, and you finish and you're a lieutenant.
What was that like?
That was stressful. That was stressful. That's like, I had a job, a fairly decent job and a fairly high responsibility. Meanwhile, the getting ready for drill, and it was just like basic training. You go there and you're going to get verbally beat up for a weekend. You're not going to get any sleep, and it's go, go. You get down there on Friday night and until Sunday evening, it's go, go, go. And you say, it's 2 days. How bad can it be? Try it. It's not that fun. And then your two-week duty, it seems like you got out of the barracks on you go down there Saturday, you get out on Sunday morning, and you're walking for 2 weeks straight. And you're sleeping 2 hours a night or 3 hours a night. And it was stressful and it was tough. And then, you had a Sunday night, it stops. You're going to be in an office the next morning with a pleasant personality. And it was stressful. Friends I made there, I still have today, great folks. I learned a lot. It was great, very, very good training. But it was tough.
But you got it.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's one of those, we started with 46 class members. We graduated 18.
Wow. So you're a second lieutenant.
Second lieutenant, and then you have to go to officer basic camp, which is your military occupation specialty, which is, again, military police. So back to Fort McClellan.
But this time back to Alabama.
This time was as a lieutenant. It's a little nicer.
Okay.
And officer basic camp, OBC, was, I don't want to say it was a walk in the park, because you did learn. It was more like going to college. And you had your own room, and you had maid service. You paid for it, but you had your own room. You had, you're off. You get up and do your PT with your unit. You go to breakfast on your own. You shower. You go to class. You sit in class till lunch. Then you go to lunch on your own. Dinner on your own. Weekends off. Most weekends off. And we were an hour and a half from Atlanta, so you'd hop in the car every Friday night. Hang out Atlanta for the weekend, and we had a really good time. The biggest challenge, the thing is, I had been an MP. I had been an MP for 9 years at the time. I knew the mission pretty well. A lot of these guys were young guys, and the academics of it was very easy for me. My biggest thing was keeping awake in class, and those classes were long. we got to learn how to watch PowerPoint presentations, and you had one after another. You had them for, 8-9 hours a day, and it was boring.
but you made it.
Yeah. It was good training. You learned. I knew the mission. I knew how MP units work, but you learn it from a different perspective, and that was neat.
So now we're now in the 90s.
Yep.
Cold War is ending.
Yeah. That's right.
And you're a second lieutenant, military police.
Yep.
What'd you do? What were your duties after you got the little bar?
I was a platoon leader at the, actually it was the 42nd MP Company, and that was in Melrose. I probably forgot to mention that before. Melrose, Massachusetts, and I was just a platoon leader. You know, it was great. It was neat. You know, they always look at new second lieutenants. This guy, what does he know? And meanwhile, I told him I got to the level of platoon sergeant as an enlisted guy, so yeah, I know a little bit more than you think I know. But that was great because once they learned that and they knew they could follow you and they knew they could trust you, they would do whatever you asked, and they'd knock down walls for you, and they did, and they were great, and that was neat. But I was only there for a year, and then I had the opportunity to be an executive officer for the 772 MP Company. I'm sorry. The 747th MP Company in Southbridge, Massachusetts. It was a brand new company. It had been deactivated in 89 and reactivated, and by then it was 94, I guess, 93, 94, and they got reactivated. So a good friend of mine, a lieutenant, she had been a lieutenant in the 97 in Desert Storm with me. She was a company commander. My platoon sergeant in Desert Storm was the first sergeant. I was the executive officer, and I had, you know, and it was really, it was a lot of the folks were folks I knew well and knew for a long time, and the new people I met were really interesting. Just had been in the, a lot of them been in the infantry, and they came over. A lot of folks in state police said, well, be an MP, you know, so it was neat. I got to meet a lot of those guys, and again, friends to this day.
And were your, I know you were a non-commissioned officer, you're now a commissioned officer. Were the MP duties similar?
Very similar, yeah. It's just, instead of being a squad leader or a platoon sergeant, leading soldiers doing that, I was a platoon leader. The biggest difference was the level at which you had to plan. And you, instead of getting my plan from the platoon leader, I was getting my plan from the company commander, or the, as an XO, I get it from the battalion commander and make a company operations order and execute training at that level.
And how long were you with the 747?
The 747 till 97.
97.
Yeah, and then I had an opportunity. I was a first lieutenant at that point. I had an opportunity to move up to a captain slot as a newly formed unit, and our battalion commander had gotten his colonel slot, and so he was going from lieutenant colonel to colonel, and he was going to be the every National Guard unit in the country, all 50 states, had to come up with an environmental trainer, my environmental training program, because one thing that the Army does better, almost as good as they do fighting wars, is pollute, and they're messy, and they're, so every unit, every state had to come up with an environmental training program, and he got the position as the colonel, and he asked me to come over with him. He had three captain slots, so he asked me to come over, and I did it. I environmental issues are big, and you know, you want to go where the spotlight's being shown. So I went there, and we developed an environmental training program for all the, we basically had to train all the units in how to train in an environmentally sensitive manner.
Can you get a little more specific?
Sure. The way I always presented it to a unit was, training environmentally is training tactically. If people can smell you from, a mile away, they're going to know where you are. If people come through your area that you were at and you left trash and you left, they're going to know that's intelligence for them. If you tread lightly and leave little behind and leave, you are going to be a much better tactical unit. So that was always my push for to get the average soldier to care about training in an environmentally sensitive manner.
All right, you're now a captain.
Yeah.
You're telling soldiers to pick up their trash?
That's right.
Pretty much.
Yep.
And how long were you in this situation?
I think 3 years.
Okay.
Well, 2001, 2002 maybe. Yeah, at that point. And I was asked, actually it had to be 2003, so it might have been a little longer because the unit started, the MP unit started getting sent overseas for the beginning of the war on terror. And the first unit was the 772 MP company from Taunton, Massachusetts. They were the first one of the MP units to get sent over. And when they came back, the guy who had been the company commander was ready to move on. That was his second tour as a commander. And the problem was all the other MP units were getting ready to be sent over, so they couldn't pull a lieutenant out to command that unit. So they asked me to command that unit.
David, let's step back a little bit to 9/11. You remember what you were doing?
I hate to say it, I forgot something here, but it was for a short time there, after the environmental unit, I was a general's aide, General Gary Pappas, who was the assistant adjutant general of Massachusetts, a one-star general, artillery guy, great guy, asked me to be, he gets to pick a captain as an aide, so he picked me, so it was nice. But yeah, I had just gotten that position in August of 2001. Sorry, I just got some of these things that you don't remember. And I just remember, I barely knew him, but then September 11th, I'm working as a corporate controller in my civilian job, and the morning of September 11th, all this happens, and I just, I said, geez, what does this mean to me? So I called the general, I go, do you need to get to the headquarters? So yeah, we went to headquarters, so he could get briefed on anything that was going on, what we needed to do, because you never knew what was going to happen. And some folks may not know this, but the Mass National Guard had an important role that day. When it was the Mass Air Guard, they had I think it's the 102nd Fighter Wing was out of Camp Edwards at the time. They were F-15 pilots, and they scrambled to fighter jets that morning because they were the closest Air Force unit to New York City. And they got there, they were about halfway there when the second plane hit, from what I understand. And who knows what they would have done if they got there. You don't know, but it was just kind of real that it was, so much of it had to do with Massachusetts, the flights left from Massachusetts and so forth. And So, you know, for the next couple of days, you don't know what's going on. A week or two weeks after that, the poor National Guard folks from New York are dead tired because they're at Ground Zero all this time. So we went down to Ground Zero, the general, two generals, myself, the operations officer for the National Guard, to see how we could get Massachusetts soldiers down to relieve these guys and get involved and see if we could help them, because they were, like I said, dead tired and exhausted emotionally too. So I got to tour Ground Zero just shortly after. You know, it was still smoking. The ground, you couldn't walk in certain places because your boots would melt. And they're walking by you with small biohazard bags that, you know, there were parts of folks that they were able to find. And that's what you saw, and it was devastating.
Intense.
No.
So. All right, let's get you back to 2003.
Yeah.
War on Terror is about to begin. You're just named commander of the 772.
That's right.
Tell us what happened next.
I was with them when they had just gotten back from a deployment. So it's and one of the reasons is because I had just started my own business. And I have an accounting firm in Cambridge, and it's one of those things where, you know, they're great at reemployment rights. If you have a job and you get activated, they'll make sure that you get your job back and so forth. But if you own your own business, there is no reemployment rights. And I, you know, basically, if I'm gone for a year, I lose all my clients. They got to go get their taxes done by somebody, and I'm not around. So they're not going to come back to me. They might, some might, but you basically, my business would be closed. And so they were nice enough to put me in a unit that was not going to get deployed. They had just gotten deployed. Half their equipment was broken down or missing. They had just gone through, they're getting toward the end of stop loss where they hadn't been able to get out since 2001. They hadn't been able to, you know, people, their enlistments were up, but they couldn't get out. All of a sudden they lifted that. Everyone scattered, everyone, you know, got out. They had done their time, and rightfully so. But so we're at 65% for personnel. We're at 58% for equipment. We weren't going anywhere. Our job was to get personnel back up, get equipment back up, and that's what we focused on. That's what my job was for the next year and a half.
And where was the unit based again?
That was Taunton, Massachusetts.
And Taunton, okay, thank you.
But one of the neat things we did in that time frame, though, was the 2004 Democratic National Convention was held at the Boston Fleet Center at the time, whatever it was, and we were tasked with security. The 211th MP Battalion and all the companies were tasked with security. So we did security for that. That was terrific. That was a lot of fun. Long days, mm-hmm. you know, and working with, you know, mostly with Secret Service and Boston Police was, but that was kind of neat. That was a lot of fun.
Were you called to service when the Red Sox won the series?
Yes, we were. And it was great because it was just shortly after the Democratic National, it was 3 months after the convention. And, The same Boston cops that we had done the DNC with, the National Convention with, we were with at the parade for the Red Sox.
Any other big social occasions?
That's exactly what they were. Sort mm-hmm. of okay. No, that was pretty much it for all the fun stuff. So I went back to. A lot of the MPs units were starting to come back at that point, and there were first lieutenants that were ready to be commanders, so they came over. Mm-hmm. I went back to being a general's aide for a little bit, back to the general's office, and I stayed there until end of 2006, where he actually retired. I had no job, so. I wanted to deploy, but I really couldn't financially. I couldn't lose my business. So they asked if I wanted to go to a finance unit. So after 23 years, I finally took a finance job in the National Guard, and I was an auditor basically, and I hated it. I lasted 6 months and I retired.
You hated it then, you hated it now.
Yeah, that's right. I didn't want to do it. I knew it was going to be boring. You're chasing down, you know, your auditing companies because they lost tents or, you know, and it's like, this isn't what I came into the Army for. And I can't really go back to a line unit because I can't deploy. And, you know, it's time for me to go.
What was your rank at the time you retired?
I was still a captain. I was in a major slot, but I was getting to the end. I wasn't going to go through all the schooling that I needed to do to check those boxes to get promoted.
All right, and did you receive any commendations or decorations?
Yeah, a couple more. We got, you know, a couple more Army Commendation Medals, and I got the Meritorious Service Medal as I was leaving the service for, mm-hmm. and that's the highest.
Now, David, did you join any veterans organizations?
Yeah, I joined the VFW, although I wasn't very active in it. And I joined, the one I really liked was the Military Order of the World Wars. It was some nice folks in there. And one of the great guys in there was I'm blanking on his name, but he was a Navy, he was a Vietnam vet, but he was a Navy guy. And he grew up in Charlestown, Massachusetts, but he also got to command USS Constitution. And that's something he always wanted to. Nice guy, but those guys are great. And I was actually involved in that group for a little while, and then, it's different. You know, a lot of the folks who were in those groups up to that point, they're from a different era, and, you know, as fathers, they weren't always the guys driving the kids because their wives didn't work. My wife works, she's a nurse, and I gotta drive the, I can't go out at night because I gotta get the kids to and from practice and stuff like that. And so I only was part of those for a while. Plus I, you know, having my own business, I don't have that much time. So I like them, and I know some of them, and they're always trying to get me to join. And I say, I'll send you some money, but I can't really spend that much time doing it.
Have you received any veterans benefits, GI Bill?
I have not.
You have not?
I have not. I don't, I'm lucky enough that I already have my degree. I'm already a CPA. I don't need an advanced degree. I never really thought mm-hmm. about it. Healthcare-wise, I'm taken care of, I'm healthy, luckily, thank you, thank God. But my wife has very good benefits at work. I don't really need those benefits. And mm-hmm. so give them to someone else who needs them, Mm-hmm. I will get, because I'm retired from the Guard, I'll get a pension when I turn 60, I think it is. And that's nice. It's part of my retirement plan.
So. It doesn't hurt.
No.
No. David, how important was it for you to serve in the military?
It wasn't ever on my radar screen, as an 18-year-old, my brothers didn't serve, my father had served, but it wasn't part of who he was as I saw him, But it was when a friend of mine joined, and I said, that's a great idea. Why don't I do it? I'll see what it's like, And I was thinking about law, even though I had my accounting education, I was thinking law enforcement, I said, that's probably a good way to get into that. And things take twists and turns down the road, but that's how I got involved. And and again, I would have only done my first 8 years and then got out, but I just loved it. It was really important to me. And I remember talking to folks when I was thinking about retiring. I said, it really is time, but I can't see myself as not being in the military. It was part of my identity. It really was. And it was torturous making that decision.
Mm-hmm. Is there anything else before we wrap up this interview?
Nothing really.
Well, David Gallo, we thank you so much for coming in and taking part in the Native Veterans Oral History Project.
Thank you so much for having me. It was great to do. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah.